LG シネマ 3D スーパートーナメント。
Up in the sky, it's a bird, it's a plane, no, it's the Super Tournament. Welcome, ladies and gentlemen. It is faster than a speed-upgraded warp prism, more powerful than a 5-3 Ultralisk. The GSL Super Tournament is back. I am Moltrap here with Wolf, and we are getting ready to cast some spectacular games today. It is still just a round of 64, but we have some great matchups for you today. I am super excited.
I am actually more excited than you are, I think, Moltrap.
I don't know,
because
man.
Marine King Prime is my favorite player in the GSL ever, and he's playing last, so I have to be a little bit patient.
Nice. I don't know. Ace is like my 15th favorite player, and he's playing today also. I don't know. I'm just really stoked about the matches today. I think they're going to be, like, this is kind of like we've seen for some of the other matches in the round of 64, where it's like players, it's like the matchups that you wouldn't say, like, oh, if I had, like, to pick my perfect show match, I would pick, you know, these two guys to play each other. But they're also, they're still really even, so I think they're going to be good matches.
Definitely.
Let's go ahead and take a look at what happened yesterday so we can kind of get some context for this. Of course, TSL Trickster 2-0-ing Yu-Gi-Oh! I haven't actually watched those VODs yet, but I heard they were pretty spectacular games. I got here, I was doing some sightseeing, right, so I got here late. But I did watch the best versus Jaejoon, the best wiping him out. MVP Genius with a beautiful timing attack, barely taking out Boxer in game three. And Slayer's Min just outplaying July Zerg and some Zerg versus Zerg. So Slayer's Min doing a very good job yesterday as well. And today, here's what we have for you. Hongan Prime versus Fox Moon. And this is one of those, you know, like I said, there's like, you wouldn't say like, oh, my perfect show match. Let's do Hongan versus Fox Moon. No, but this is going to be a good set regardless. I think they're evenly matched, and it's going to be fun stuff. Revival versus Ensnare is also going to be pretty good. Revival, he's that guy that did those crazy roach drops versus Terran and Code A, so let's see some more out of him. And I'm really looking forward to Fruit Dealer versus Ace. I think that, I just got this nerd chill feeling going down my spine. That is going to be some sick games.
He is so unpredictable, so we'll see how that goes.
Yeah. And then Squirtle versus Marine King's going to close things out for us.
Yeah, that's what I'm really excited about. So, of course, Squirtle showed us some awesome games in the Team League versus MVP. That game, the most epic game ever that everyone always talks about.
Really?
Well, you know, everyone always talks about that game, Moltrap. You didn't talk about it?
First time I've heard someone talk about it.
Well, you probably should go back and watch that VOD.
I probably should.
It was the first Team League, I believe, and it was
I like vaguely remember it, but I don't remember it as much. I don't remember it being that epic. What was epic about it?
Well, it was just a really long game on Terminus Re, and there were motherships involved, a lot of Blink Stalker control, tons of bases being taken all over the map, so we'll see something like that maybe.
It's always cool when there's motherships involved. And,
yeah, like yesterday, there was a mothership.
Exactly.
That was pretty awesome.
The Trickster games. There was some mothership action. Anyway, let's get started here looking at the players for our first matchup. There is Hongan Prime, Protoss player, GSL rank 13th. He's been around for a while, got points from January, March, and May. Always hanging around in Code S. And versus Zerg, 6 wins and 2 losses, a 75% win rate in recent versus Zerg. But look at that, recent sets in general, only 3-7. So Hongan, not looking too good. He got knocked down in the up and down matches right out of his Code S group. He did stay in Code S, but he still got a little bit of proving to do. There's the man himself right now.
Drinking some Gatorade, it looks like.
Yeah. And it's interesting, these guys actually played before. We're going to see Moon in just a moment here. But they actually played in the up and down matches in Season 1.
Yeah, a long time ago.
And Hongan helped knock Moon down to Code A that season.
So we'll see if he can get some revenge.
And there's Moon himself. GSL ranking 59th, has had some bad luck lately. You know, he was up there in that first season, Code A. Got knocked down to Code A. Code S got knocked down to Code A again. And then the previous season just got eliminated in the first round by Virus. So he is no longer even in Code A right now.
Yeah, his GSL results have not been extremely impressive. A lot of people remember him for making it to the finals of Intel Extreme Masters, losing to Ace. So
Yeah.
We'll see how he can prove himself here maybe today. He really hasn't been that impressive, but he's definitely a solid player. We'll see what he can show us today. Maybe he's got some specific builds planned here against Hongan. Hongan, a very resilient player, though, so I don't think we'll see too many all-ins.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, Moon, it's weird. He's like, he's been doing really bad in GSL. He's been doing really bad, not showing good results, but in foreign tournaments, he's been doing really well.
Yeah.
You know, he beat Squirtle a couple times in IEM. Only lost 3-2 versus Ace in the IEM finals, so he took second there. He's doing really well in the NASL as well. So yeah, he's been doing well like in foreign tournaments, but he's gonna have to step it up a little bit. Hongan, not the best Protoss and Codas by far, but definitely a little bit stronger, I think, than what he's been finding abroad.
Exactly.
So he's gonna have his work cut out for him there.
We'll see how he does. The first map, of course, is Metalopolis. See if Hongan is gonna show some PvZ dominance, or is Moon gonna show us that he's gonna do a little bit better this time in the Super Tournament.
Yeah. Yeah, Hongan, like I said before, not a ton of success. He's got some proving, Moon's got some proving. Let's see who can prove themselves best.
Holy Prime Week versus Fox Moon.
All right, here we have our Protoss player. Still stayed in Codas. Definitely the favorite in this matchup.
Hongan Prime Wii.
Prime Wii. Protoss versus Zerg is actually his best matchup statistically. He's
definitely
at 13-7, 65%. And meanwhile, this is the Zerg he has to face. Legendary 5th race Warcraft 3 player. He is... Fox Moon.
Well,
trying to earn his way StarCraft 2 history as well.
They are cross positions, so that does give Moon a little bit of confidence. A lot of Protoss players have been using Stargate builds nowadays, but even so, cross positions, it's much more difficult to hit the timings with those really, really early Phoenix attacks that follow up the Void Rift. It's been giving Zergs a lot of trouble right now.
There's our studio. Yeah, it might be able to give Moon some trouble there. Now, Hongan, I was mentioning this is his best matchup, but we actually haven't seen him play versus Zerg publicly in a long time. He's only played one public game since that first season, which was a loss to Kyrix. So that's why I'm thinking, like, you know, he still has a little bit of proving to do here, because you can't rest on your laurels in the GSL.
You definitely can't. That's one thing that everyone who watches the GSL has been learning, especially recently.
Yeah.
It looks like Moon is going to be doing a speed link expand. Wants to play it very safe. Probe there sitting to try to block the natural. Of course, Zerglings are on the way, so that probe's going to have to skedaddle pretty soon. Second gas is being taken back at home for Hongan.
There we go.
Maybe wanting to do a 3-gate sentry expand, which is definitely the most common Protoss versus Zerg build out there right now.
Yeah. Yeah, and, you know, a lot of Zergs used to be like, what can I do against that? There's nothing I can do. He's got sentries. I can't attack sentries? No, what are you thinking? And then a couple players came along by the names of Lucira and Nesty and said, hey, let me show you the way. It's called attacking the Protoss while they're weak. And the other Protosses were like, or the other Zergs were like, oh, hey, whoa, I should try that. So the 3-gate expand is not invulnerable anymore. If you move out at the wrong moment and the Zerg comes in with roaches and lings and catches you off guard, you can perish. Or we used to even see Protoss players would like walk across the map with like 6 sentries and a zealot to try and prompt Zerglings, and then they would get surrounded by Zerglings and destroyed. So definitely some back and forth. Scouting's going to be important to see what the other players are up to and counter it.
Now, speaking of scouting, the Zerglings ran forward and they saw a Stalker. When you see a Stalker, it usually indicates that your opponent is doing some sort of tech. And so when you see that, it kind of makes you feel like, oh, maybe he's teching. It could be a 4-gate. I want to try to get in there and see if he has second gas. Now he sees a sentry. By the way, a lot of players have been making that first Stalker nowadays, trying to deter the Zerg scouting, make him feel like he's a little bit vulnerable, rather than just saying, oh, sentries, it's going to be a sentry expand, I can do whatever I want. But only 2 gateways right now for Hongan. Maybe trying to skimp a little bit, get that expansion up faster.
Exactly. Yeah, and yeah, the Stalkers are handy to have because then, oh wow, that is a fast expansion.
This actually is a build that someone posted a thread on TL about recently. It's doing two gateways instead of three for a century expand. I've been playing around with it a little bit. It's actually been giving me a lot of success, so maybe it's becoming popular on the Korean servers now as well. So I think that that's what we're going to see here from Hongin. We'll see how he can execute it, though.
That is interesting.
It's very, very risky against Roach Speedling All-Ins.
Yeah, I mean, he's got, like, two sentries right now. So normally, the three-sentry expand, or the three-gate expand, part of that is you get, like, six sentries. So when you do move down your ramp, I mean, sometimes less. It's been less and less lately. But when you do move down your ramp, you've got something in place that if they do attack with something, you could force field the crap out of everything and fall back. But with only the two sentries, now three, he's not going to be able to do that nearly as well, and he doesn't really have a lot of information. He's just kind of assuming that Moon is going to go for a more longer-term game, but he does have a nice wall up, at least.
Yeah, you've got to get that Forge up ASAP, because that, like I said, is the vulnerability, the Roach Speedling all in. It looks like, though, Moon is thinking about taking a very fast third.
I think it's a good idea.
Drone's patrolling there. He's thinking about it. Hasn't chosen his career path. Oh, he just chose it. He's going to be a hatchery. Very fast plus one melee attack. We've seen Zergs do that a lot in PTZ.
He took one of those tests in school that's like, fill out a bunch of questions about your personality and your interests, and it's like, congratulations, you're set out, you'd be good at as a sanitation worker.
Yeah, I took one of those in high school, too, and it told me I should be like a nuclear physicist. I was like, no, I don't think so.
Yeah, I don't remember. I remember the one that I took said, like, I should be something, I don't remember what it was, but it was something I was completely uninterested in. I was like, oh, that's lame. But so I hope that drone didn't make its choice to become a hatchery based on that, because it might be a little disappointed 30 years down the line when it's retired and has an unfulfilled life.
Blink is on the way.
Sorry.
No, that's a good joke, man. I mean, the Overmind made him do it, actually. That's the Overmind
that's
took a career path test for him. And so Blink, falling top with Blink allows you to be very aggressive. Nice trap of those Zerglings there. Allows you to be very aggressive and sometimes pressure that third base, force cancels. But Moon getting that third base up very quickly is going to allow him to have a little bit better creep spread. And he should be able to defend it because of the timing here. Just now starting to produce those roaches.
Now,
go ahead. I don't want to interrupt you.
No, that's all right. I was interrupting you, but I was going to say, I wonder if he realizes that Blink might be on the way. He hasn't scouted it, but there's only three sentries there and lots of stalkers. And usually Protoss like to build up those sentries early so they can get a ton of force field save up for later. The fact that he's got mostly stalkers is a little bit more, feels a little bit more aggressive than your standard PVZ. So he might suspect the Blink just because he does see so many stalkers. I'm not sure if that would cross his mind or not, though.
Exactly. Now, we do see Hongin slamming out three more gateways, so he really does want to be aggressive. And this kind of is the style of Protoss versus Zerg right now. Tech up a little bit, throw down about six gateways, and attack your opponent's third base if he's taking it. I think that's exactly what we're going to see from Hongin here. Plus two melee attacks on the way for Moon right now, so he really wants to get those Zerglings beefed up, and that's going to be quite helpful against the Stalkers, assuming that he can engage them properly.
And is that just plus one weapons for the Protoss that's
yes,
upgrading
it is
right
plus
now?
One. Yeah. Yeah, plus two is on the way. He already has plus one.
Okay. So staying about even with the Protoss is a good idea, and Burrow being researched as well, and a lot of Roaches, so we are probably going to see some heavy Roach play with Zerglings as well because of the melee attacks.
Oh, this attack is so scary, Moltrap. I'm not sure if Moon can hold it. He has plenty of Roaches, but they do not yet have speed or Burrow.
He can fall back to that creep if he needs to. Oh, surround with the Zerglings coming from the side to trap them. But they do have Blink if they need to get out of there. A couple do not Blink properly and lose their lives. But a nice attempt at a trap by Moon. Didn't quite spring it. Didn't go as well as he wanted. Here he goes backing up the ramp. That's going to be good for Hongin. But a good concave for Moon regardless. Picking off Stalkers, and that Warpin is going to drive those Roaches back. You're right, he might not be able to hold this off.
He is blinking back, though. And you know, it's not a good idea to engage the concave. Both these players are actually making that mistake.
Yeah.
But it looks like right now, Moon has the better end of the deal. Does not want to force his way up that ramp, though. Is backing away. The Zerglings do have plus two now. Or actually, it's almost on, not quite. And Zerglings just not really getting any hits in this battle, though.
Whoa, actually, Hongin needs to back up here. All of his Stalkers in the front are hurt, and the ones in the back are hurt as well, so he can't really blink that much, but he does blink the uninjured ones forward. He takes some damage, and it looks like he has a lead over these Roaches. More Roaches and Link streaming in, though, and it looks like Fox is barely going to drive him back for the moment. I think Hongin might need to regroup. I don't know if he's going to let him regroup or not.
And Burrow finishes, so now this attack is basically going to end. Assuming that he can get just a few more Roaches out, he does have 10 Roaches in production right now. Roach speed is almost done as well. Oh, but he's throwing away a lot of his Roaches here.
Oh, man.
Konga does not have an observer, so he shouldn't really be doing this.
Yeah, that was really dangerous. I don't know why he blinked over the Burrowed Roaches. And he's losing so many Stalkers now because he's got nowhere to blink. He can't blink either way because there's Roaches on both sides. Finally, some reinforcements coming in. He is really going all out with this attack. He's just throwing Stalkers into the mix as fast as he can.
Some really good Blink Stalker micro here from Hong, and Moon threw away a lot of those Roaches earlier. Now, even though he has Burrow, he just doesn't have enough Roaches to deal with these Stalkers. More, keep warping in six more every time. And I think Moon is actually going to be pretty dead here in a second. He's just losing too many Roaches. He doesn't have the economy to keep producing them as fast as Hongan can produce the Stalkers.
Yeah, Hongan is barely outproducing him. And here he comes in. He's going to start hitting the hatchery now. And here's the thing. Moon has 1,300 minerals in the bank. If he had another hatchery or something, he could actually produce enough to hold this off, but he doesn't have the production capabilities. Having to pull drones, this might be the end for at least Moon's third base. And just a few Roaches just holding things off. Hongan is going to take out that hatchery in moments, and we'll see if Moon decides to keep fighting or not. He should really be doing a counterattack or something if he's not going to try and hold that third base.
Yeah, he does. Now that hatchery is done, Hongan has two choices. He can continue to pressure forward, try to end this game, or he can just go back and take a third, but it looks like he is going to try to end it. Loses that fourth pylon, though, but it looks like there may be too many Stalkers, even some Sentries joining in the mix now. Roaches can barely fight, and I think Bull Trap, this may be the end for Moon in this first game.
Yeah, Moon just didn't have the production to hold things up, and here he is going to lose his natural expansion very soon. And despite the Burrow, yeah, he just didn't have enough to deal with this. Too many Stalkers coming in, and now Hongan has the overwhelming advantage. There's nothing Moon can do at this point, and he is, in fact, barely even moving. There's the GG from Moon. Hongan Prime still has his versus Zerg and takes game one.
Taking a sip of that Gatorade. Taking a second sip. You see, almost put the cap on.
Wow, the double sip, man.
He was like, no, oh, see, he just did it again. He's like,
whoa.
He wants a third sip. He's so aggressive.
I can't believe, man, that he just went all out with that sipping, man. One sip, and then, like, the Roaches came in, but he just sipped again. Zerglings came in and just sipped again.
Yeah.
And he downed the Gatorade of victory.
He did.
Right in front of Moon's face.
Now, I want to talk a little bit about the Roaches there. They had Burrow, and he didn't have enough Roaches to fight the Stalkers head-on, but he burrowed some of the Roaches, and then if he had burrowed all the Roaches and just left it there, I think he thought Hongan's got an observer coming, so I can't just leave these here, they'll all die. But if he had just left the Roaches burrowed and then more Roaches came in and he just kept burrowing them, Hongan might have been able to snipe the hatchery, but then all the Roaches would have popped back up, killed all the Stalkers, and we had a chance to defend. But instead, he just decided to fight head on. If he had just waited for a few more Roaches using that burrow, probably would have been able to hold it.
Yeah, I mean, so for those of you that are kind of newer to StarCraft, whenever you're outnumbered, it's bad because then they have more firepower than you do. So if you burrow the Roaches, they're out of the fight. And then if you get another batch of Roaches in and you unburrow, suddenly instead of fighting little to none and little to a lot, you've got both coming, you've got even numbers.
Right.
So you can actually stand a chance in the fight, and your hatchery might take some damage in the meantime. But anyway, I'm surprised Hongan, when those Roaches burrowed, he actually is like, oh, the Roaches are gone. I must have killed them. I'm just going to walk over them.
Yeah, that was a little bit funky, and Moon almost had a chance to come back there at that moment.
Yeah, so kind of let himself get surrounded. Interesting choice, though, but he just had too much output of Stalkers. Even though he probably could have even had another gateway when Stalkers coming out, because he was not spending his money completely either.
Yeah, just didn't have him. He needed Chrono Boost maybe a little bit more, those gateways going.
But man, if Moon, if he'd had a queen at his third, or another hatchery, I think he could have held that off because he had money in the bank, but just not the production to actually use it.
Exactly. Another hatchery or just not missing any larva injects. I'm not sure if he missed any, wasn't able to quite check that, but he just had a little bit more production.
Did he have a queen at his third? I don't think he did.
He did, but it got killed early
on. That's there you go. Anyway, so next map is going to be Zelnaga Caverns. We'll see if Moon can pull it back out, get it to an ace match, or if Hongan can close out the victory.